Okay, now I would like to talk on different phenomena concerning detonation. Up to now, I have talked about either steady phenomena or quasi-steady phenomena. Now I am going to enter topics that are more difficult because they are fully unsteady. The first topic I would like to the first topic I I try to follow your advice, but okay. What is called galloping detonation? What are galloping detonation? When in the last century, in the 16th, people in Los Alamos start to develop direct numerical simulation of detonation. They did to begin with in the planar case, one-dimensional case, and what did they saw immediately? That they did not get a detonation that we are expecting to see. They see a solution that is pulsating. And this is known as a galloping detonation. Excuse me. This is known as galloping detonation. So let me tell you, okay, this is, I will start with a physical mechanism, and it looks to me that it's the most important thing to understand. Then the rest is more technical. But okay, what are the physical mechanisms? First of all, as I told you, here this is a profile of reaction rate behind a detonation for different velocity of the detonation, detonations that are sustained by a piston. So you have different velocities. In red, it's a high velocity. In green, it's a lower velocity. But velocity of detonation gives you different velocity of the Neumann temperature. So here you are, I guess, I don't see clearly, but here it should be the Neumann temperature. Maybe on the left, you have the, I cannot see that. Maybe on the left, you have the velocity, I don't know. Now, here is the picture. The picture you have. Now I am working in the reference frame of the shock. Okay, so I have a supersonic flow on the left called mixture that causes the shock, and then you have an induction delay, and then start the heat release here. It turns out that I told you very early. They saw an oscillation between these two regions, between the shock and the heat release zone. Okay, there is a nice experiment that you, which is also reported in the book of Professor Lowe, which is an experiment developed early, which is a bluff body, which is a bullet. In a reactive mixture, the bullet is supersonic, and so in front of the bullet, there is a shock, as Ernst Mach. So, you remember this experiment of Ernst Mach with a gun, but he did that in a reactive mixture. I don't remember what the reactive mixture. And what you see here is oscillation behind. And this is a Schlieren picture. And the oscillation behind, as are the trace of an oscillation in the nose between the reaction and the shock. So, in fact, there is an instability mechanism that developed here between the two. So it is not so difficult to understand this effect. If you change the flow velocity, if you change the velocity of the shock, okay, you change the temperature. Yeah. If you change the temperature, you change the induction length. But you know, behind the induction length, you have a reaction rate. And this is producing, if you like, something like a gas expansion. change the gas expansion, change the volume. So this is going to send back a signal changing again the velocity of the shock. So you have a loop, a feedback loop, which can develop. So now, what are the mechanisms to exchange information between the shock and the heat release, the region of heat release? There are two basic mechanisms. First of all, the first one is behind of the shock. You have the flow velocity, which I called in the previous lecture UN, Neumann velocity, which is subsonic. And this, you have a convection transfer of anything. If you change the temperature is propagated at the velocity, I talk in that case of entropy, is propagated with the velocity of the flow relative to the shock. This is a way. So, and now you have the acoustic effects. Acoustics send a signal propagating with the speed of the sound back and forth in the two directions. This is why the problem is so complicated to solve analytically. It is because you have three ways to couple for this loop. Two-way on, which is propagation at the flow velocity. I call that the entropy way. The other way on is the pressure effect that also transport temperature by compression, adiabatic compression. And this is go to the with the speed of the sound. But as you will see, the temperature which is propagated by this effect is smaller than the propagation by the entropy waves here. So you have this, and this one is subsonic, and the blue one is supersonic. Okay, it's sonic, not supersonic. It's sonic. And now how you to close the loop? You have to now, okay. If you have a change in the shock in the Neumann state, okay, you are going to perturb the reaction rate. But now you have to send back the information to the shock to close the loop, and this is can be only by acoustic. So you see, you have a mechanism even in planar case, which is not so easy to solve analytically because you have three mechanisms of propagation for propagating the information and propagating the temperature and so on. Okay, this is what I say. You have two different coupling mechanisms, entropy waves in one direction from the shock to the burn gas, acoustic wave in both directions, upwards, downwards. Okay. This problem can be solved analytically because it was, as I told you, it was solved numerically. But when you solve numerically, you have a result. And this is important. The result tells you, oh, this structure is going to oscillate naturally. Not all the time, but most of the time. But how? Why? At what is the critical value? When it is not, and this, all this information can be obtained by analytical expression, because analytical expression, you have everything in the expression, so you may study the different effects. The problem is that, as I let you anticipate, it is difficult to solve this problem analytically when you take into account everything. There are two limits where you may solve this problem. One limit is strong overdriven regime. What does that mean? Means that the shock is strong. A strong shock. And you have to add, to simplify the problem. What does that mean, simplify the problem? To decorrelate these three mechanism in order that they are not so influenced, they do not have so many influence between each other, because this is a problem. So to do that, you used a limit which is called the Newtonian limit, with specific it, ratio specific it, minus unity, which is not very large. You know why it is called Newtonian limit? Does anybody know that? Does anybody know what the prediction of Newton for the speed of sound? Do you know this story? No?
Textbook.
No, it is not written in many textbooks. It's the story is the following. Newton, you know, maybe the greatest genius in all the humanity. Maybe. So if it is not the greatest, it is one of the greatest. What did he do? He tried to understand the sound. So he looked for compression and dilatation. As I told you, he did not write any equation. That's the first point. So he think without equations, which is extremely difficult. And what he did, he assumed that the compression was isotherm. He assumed that P is proportional to T. Rho, you know, he assumed that there is, P proportional to rho, that T is constant. He does not put P equal rho gamma when you are adiabatic. When you are doing acoustic waves, now you know that the frequency is sufficiently high so that you have no time to exchange heat by conduction and so on, so you are adiabatic. Newton does not know that. He just knows that when you change the volume, you change the pressure. He uses a linear relation between them. And what he obtained? The sound speed for gamma equal 1. But the sound speed of gamma equal 1, this gives you, because it is square root, you have a correction of 1.3, 1.4 in front of the velocity. And this was very, very early. It was the scientists realized that there is something that is wrong. It's not exactly the what. And you know who the first who find out the answer? Laplace, the Frenchman. Le Marquis de Laplace, who is one of the great scientists also of the 19th century. You know, I have a lot of story with Laplace, but if I start with the story of Laplace, you will not know anything about detonation. So this is the first. So the first thing is to the first limit where one can solve the problem is this limit. Strong overdriven, you will see why, and a Newtonian limit. The second limit is just the opposite. It is Chapman-Jouguet regime that we should call Michelson regime, as I explained to you, but now. And for small heat release, which is not realistic at all, because you cannot have, it does not exist, Chapman-Jouguet detonation with small. But it is interesting to look at that limit, because it is just the opposite of the other. Now you, in the first one, what is simplifying the problem is that the flow behind is quasi-isobaric, is very, very subsonic. The flow relative to the, in the first limit, the flow relative to the shock is in the compressed shock, in the compressed gas, is subsonic. So acoustic does not play a strong effect. So you can say acoustic is instantaneous. So everything is controlled by the longer delay in the loop, which is the entropy wave. In the other limit, it is just the opposite. Acoustic are essential because you are fully compressible phenomena, even behind. So this is why the two effects are interesting. In the first limit, the acoustic waves one cannot say they are not useful. They are useful, but they have an infinite velocity. So that to close the loop, it is infinitely quick, infinitely rapid. So the loop in the loop, the only delay you have is due to the entropy wave. This is why you are able to save, to solve this problem. In the other limit, it is just the opposite. The entropy wave is not important, and only the acoustic wave have to be taken into account. Okay, now this is to give you an overview why we are investigating limit in order to get some analytical result and to better understand the phenomena. This was done with the first analysis was done with Lontin Hay, and the second was done in collaboration with Forman Williams. So here I have written, we may skip that. This I have written in the general formulation without approximation. This is for you, for those who are interested in this problem. I don't know if you are going to be, some of you may be interested. They have all the detail here. What I want to show you is the limiting case. Okay. Okay. Strong first approximation. Strong shock. Let me take this out. Okay. Now you look what is written just behind that. Strong shock in the Newtonian approximation. What does that mean? That means that the Mach number is very large. Okay? Mach number of propagation. Velocity of the shock divided by the acoustic velocity, by the flow, by the speed of sound in front of the shock. Very large number. Very large means 6, 7 is very large for me, okay? And now you need gamma minus 1 smaller than unity. Now, look, this is the simplification. Here you have the exact relation between the Mach number, which is the flow velocity divided by the local sound velocity, which is A behind in the compressed gas. So this is called Mach number at the Neumann state. This Mach number, this is a complete expression. If you have this relation, here is the result, is the approximation that you obtain. And you see immediately that the Mach number is very small. So, in other words, when I am in this limit, the shock, the velocity, the propagation velocity of the shock is very fast, but relative to the shock, the gas in the burned gas, in the shock gas, the velocity is much slower, much smaller than the local speed of the sound. So we are in a sense in a limit similar to a flame, but except to the fact that we may look to an intermediate case where the dissipative effects are still negligible in such a way that we are working in the limit where I may forget about the acoustics, but I may also forget about the dissipative effect. So this is an intermediate limit that helps to solve the problem, and it turns out that when you compare this result, analytical result, obtained with this simplification to direct numerical simulation, it works very well. Okay? So this is the limit. Now I have a small parameter which is associated with the Mach number in the shocked gas, and this is a we call that a distinguished limit. But let me skip these things and go back and go up to the result. The first point is, as I let you know, that the pressure is not important in the energy equation. So the energy equation is a pure, okay. Here it is simplified because I have used a mass-weighted coordinate, but forget about the detail. So what is important here in this energy equation, there is no pressure because I am subsonic, and I can neglect the the effect of the compressibility effect in the energy equation. And I have an equation, a similar equation for the, let's say, for one one-step reaction, this is limiting, this is reduced mass fraction of the limiting component. So here the equation you have to solve. You know, there are first order differential equations. The nonlinear term is a production term. There is no diffusive term, which were the key in flame propagation, but here it's not necessary. It is like if I have, but what I have at the initial condition at the x equals zero here correspond to the position of the Neumann at the Neumann state. Here I have a condition, jump condition that I have to apply. Let me now, and I assume large sensitivity of the Neumann to the sensitivity of the induction length to the temperature, or let's say even to the reaction length to the temperature. Okay, forget about the detail. Let me go to the result. Here are the solutions, but I don't, voilà, oh here, okay. Okay, forget about all the, what is written above this here. This temperature, this theta is theta T, big theta, no, but not big. theta, capital theta, N is for Neumann state. This is a temperature, reduced temperature, okay? The reduced temperature behind the Neumann state, which is associated directly with the velocity of the shock wave. And here, this omega is a reaction rate, which is a result of the reaction rate when you solve this equation, which are a delay, which are simply, you know, the solution for the temperature and the concentration is simply given by the steady state solution, but with a delay temperature, which is due to at the Neumann state, which is due that you have to propagate the information with the speed of the with the velocity. So you have a delay here. And now this is the profile, you know, omega theta. Forget about now t minus x here. For omega theta x, this is the profile of the reaction rate when you give the Neumann temperature and when you assume it is fixed. However, the Neumann temperature is not fixed. So what happened? You have now a delay in the Neumann temperature, because before the information reaches the point where you are, you have to wait the time it takes by the flow velocity to go from the shock up to this point. This is the delay. But this is omega theta x is a steady temperature. It's easy to obtain this. But now you see, and why I have an integral here, it is because I want to conserve the mass that I have inside my between the shock and the burn gas. And this is a conservation of the mass. And why you obtain a so simple equation? It is simply because I have assumed I was working in the limit where the pressure is negligible. And my only mechanism of propagation is what is called the entropy wave, which propagates with the flow velocity. And you have such a strange nonlinear equation, which has nothing to do with the flame and so on. But I have to tell you that this theta, once again, was obtained for high activation energy. Now, when you have such equation, it's an integral equation, you have to go to the numeric to see the result. It's one cannot have an analytical solution for this equation. But the equation is simple. What you can do is just linearize the equation, you know. If you linearize this equation, Okay, you linearize the equation, and then you obtain a linear integral equation. Because I have to integrate across the detonation structure, you see? And now, this is a typical reaction rate. And let me tell you, so you end up with an equation of that type where B here, you know, this constant that you have here depend on the activation energy, depend on the ratio of specific heat minus one multiplied by the heat release per unit mass, okay? You reduce by the temperature, eh? Okay, in the steady state. So you have a number here, and you have now in this equation you have two non-dimensional quantity. You have this number, and you have the shape of this omega prime, which is which is the sensitivity of the reaction rate to the temperature, which has typical shape, typical that. Typical of this form, because it is a derivative of this when you change the temperature. But once again, this is this function that you have here is a characteristic of the steady state. Okay, you obtain this function from the steady state equation for different velocity of the shock. So. It's very nice. Now it's not difficult to put that. In fact, it can be solved in. I skip this point. This can be solved for particular form of this. It can be solved analytically. And what do you find when you do that? You find, you know, now you are looking for an expression where the time, the variation of, with the time of this unknown function theta and t is of the exponential time type, okay, and you look for the value of the growth or damping rate. But this now is a complex number, where omega is a frequency and s here is the growth rate. Positive, it is unstable. Negative, it is stable. And now, what you obtain for typical shape like that. You obtain a critical value, you know, here are the, okay, the spectrum is discrete at the first point. The first point that the spectrum is discrete. That doesn't mean that you have a discrete set of sigma here satisfying this integral equation here. And this discrete set is in red here, have negative S, for beta, which are not sufficiently large. So when beta minus one, excuse me, when beta minus one is not large, that is when the activation energy is not large, or when the heat release per unit mass divided by the thermal energy at the Neumann state is not sufficiently strong, you are stable. Now, if you increase B minus one, that is, if you decrease B, yeah, now you have a point where the real value S is zero. This is what we call Poincaré-Andronov off bifurcation, because you have a bifurcation at a finite oscillation velocity, oscillation rate. And this is, and so the important point result is the following. The oscillatory instability is promoted by an increase of either the thermal sensitivity, either the heat release, or also the stiffness of this reaction here, of this function, which is like that. So now this is very interesting for one reason. For example, what you say now is that I would like to see what the square wave model is going to give to me. Because you remember this square wave model that I have used. Well, now I want to see what it is giving here. It gives very bad result because it shows you that the the equation is singular. That the result of that you have an infinite set of eigenvalue without limit, without upper bound for the growth rate. And this turns out to be an equation of the advanced type, in the sense that the derivative it depends on the value of the function later. And this, you know, when the derivative of a function depends on this value later, this is a singular problem. This cannot work. It means that you cannot use the square wave model to study dynamical problem. It's good to study the problem, the quasi-steady-state problem, and so on, not the dynamical problem. Okay, this is why some work are completely stupid, because some of people were looking to the dynamics of flame in the square wave model. You can throw that to the basket. Okay, now a similar work has been done in the other limit, which is Chapman-Jouguet detonation, small it release. And it, now I go up to the end because I don't want to give you this. Okay, what is the key point now? The key point is the following, that when I am close to a CJ wave with small it release, the problem is such that the strength of the shock is weak, so that d is close to the speed of sound. Everything is close, every velocity is close to the speed of sound, so that you have what the mathematician, or no, the fluid mechanical people call a transonic flow. Everything is close to the sound of the speed of sound. And in that case, it turns out that what in this loop, you know, if the velocity is going downward to with a value close to the speed of sound, when the acoustic wave go upwards with a velocity equal to the speed of sound, this means that it will take a long time to close the loop. In other words, now the longest step in the loop is not the entropy waves that are negligible, but is the acoustic wave propagating the information from the burned gas up to the shock. So it's just the opposite of I have described. This is why it is interesting, because now we are able to solve the problem in the two limit, and then you may say, okay, in the middle, I may have an idea to what is the situation. And let me go to the end and to show you the result. It's the calculation are rather involved, but okay, here is the equation. You end up with a similar equation, an integral equation, you see. Well, I have put the delay here instead of to put it here, but this is the same. You have a delay integral equation, delay by the acoustic propagating upwards. And you have now two in the kernel, you have two effects. One is the thermal sensitivity. Again, this is the instability. And this term, which is a stabilizing term, is due to the residual compressible effect. So this is very interesting, because it tells you that even close to CJ, in fact, the unstable mechanism is due to the thermal sensitivity. It is not at all a thermal acoustic instability. It's just it is not a thermal acoustic instability. So this may explain why it took so long to understand this galloping detonation. Because people thought that the instability of a detonation were basically similar, that the mechanisms were basically similar to that of a thermoacoustic instability. This work shows that just the opposite. It is not a thermodynamic instability. The pressure effects are stabilizing. Okay? The pressure effects are stabilizing. What is destabilizing is the thermal sensitivity. Okay. Okay, this is the conclusion. Galloping detonations are due to a fast shift in the loop between the local heat shock, between the lead shock and the heat release, controlled by the entropy wave and the upstream running acoustic wave. Okay. Now, we are going to the next lecture. Which is the 13th one. So I am not sure that I go through all the lecture. We'll see. What is the, okay. This one is also an interesting lecture. Maybe more easy to follow. Okay. Shock waves. Now I be back to pure shock waves. Okay? No reaction. I want just to have an idea, to show you an idea what are the shock waves. Okay. Okay. A shock wave can be considered as an hydrodynamic discontinuity satisfying Rankine-Ugonio condition. Why the problem is not okay? What is simplifying the problem compared to a detonation is that the flow, the medium is uniform, the gas is uniform in both on both sides. It is uniform, okay, on both sides in the steady state. It is uniform in the steady state. So if you have a uniform steady state, when you work in perturbation around the steady state, you are going to obtain differential equations with constant coefficient because the steady state is uniform. What makes the flame or the detonation difficult is that when you, even in the linear approximation, is that when you linearize the thing, you have non-uniform coefficients, and this makes the life more difficult to solve analytically. That's all. And in that case, you can solve. Even that, the problem is not so simple. And there are many stupid things there are many wrong results that are written on this problem. flow velocity, the diffusion. Well, okay. Now, I will neglect all the diffusive effects. Why? Because the speed of flow that are involved is sufficiently large to dominate, for the convection to dominate completely the diffusion mechanism. So you may forget about viscosity, heat conduction, and so on. You may add that in the second step to just to see the modification, but not in the dominant. So what is important in that case, that the entropy, you know, as I already said, the entropy, if you make the velocity of the shock changing in time, you cannot use a constant isentropic. You are no longer isentropic, but simply, the entropy is simply convected now by the flow. So this is relatively simple, but it is not an isentropic problem. because the entropy is changing in time at the Neumann state. Now, a very simple result is comes from the linearized equation in a uniform media. When you linearize the Euler equation in a uniform media, this is well written in some book. For example, Landau book, it is well written. You know, here are the linearization. You see, this is a continuity equation, okay? These are Euler equation, and then you have the entropy propagation. And you have the speed of the sound, which is defined at the pressure, the derivative of the pressure by the density at entropy, at constant entropy. Now, it's from this equation now, it's easy to eliminate the density, you know, you eliminate the density from this equation, and you obtain this equation here. And if you eliminate U and W, you obtain the Poisson equation or D'Alembert equation for the pressure. Now, in this derivative here, because of the flow velocity, which is non-zero, this is a particulate derivative here. It is not the partial derivative, it's the particulate derivative. I have written here, it's here, which is the part, which is the partial differential derivative time partial derivative with respect to space with the flow velocity. And you know what is interesting in that in this when you linearize Euler in the linear approximation, what is very interesting is how all the pressure is taken in charge by the acoustic wave. That's very good because take out the pressure, the rest is the rest of the flow that you have to consider is isobaric. You take out the pressure because you know the solution which is here, and the rest of the flow is isobaric. So, okay. The flow can be split in two parts. One acoustic part with a label A, and one which is with a label I is for incompressible, is what is called the vorticity wave. So you have an acoustic wave, okay, you have acoustic and vorticity. And now the equation for the incompressible flow are the, maybe it is written here. I would like you to understand that. Okay. Oh. All right. Excuse me. I pushed the wrong button. Okay. Okay. I want to be back to show you something. No, maybe it is here. Where is it? Okay. Now, when you take out the pressure here, because this is taken into account. Because you are linear, so the solution is a superposition of the you are linear, okay? And if the pressure effect is taken into account by the acoustics, the rest of the flow, you know, acoustic flow satisfies all this equation, okay, and takes all the pressure, so that you are left with another component of the flow, which is this given by this equation without pressure. And this is called, and this equation is the particulate derivative equals zero as the acoustic, as the entropy. Same equation for the flow as the equation of the entropy. This is why we call that, it is called, it's not me, eh? It's it is called an entropy vorticity wave. And why it is vorticity? Because you will, this is a vertical flow. It's not a potential flow, okay? So when you have that in mind, this is interesting, you know. I don't know, maybe some of you know that already, if you are, I don't know. You decompose in the flow, the linear, eh? You are in linear approximation, be careful. You cannot do that. Yeah, there are two limitations. One is to be linear, and the other is to have a steady state which is uniform. Otherwise, if one of these two assumptions is not right, the problem is much more complicated. So, but before to study complicated problems, it's worth studying simple problems, okay? Simple, you will see it is not so simple. Eh? So in that case, you know exactly the solution in terms of the initial, because it is just propagate at the constant flow velocity, you know the form of the field of the incompressible flow of vorticity. So because it is just convected as the entropy was, is. Now you have an additional condition that this flow should be incompressible. Why? It is because the pressure is zero. So because you are because you have this term which is coming from the density variation that goes out, because every density, every pressure, not every for the density, you have to be, but this does not, for the pressure does not occur. So you have an additional condition that this flow is this, the vorticity, vorticity entropy flow is incompressible. So the life is much more easy. Now you work in the normal mode analysis. What does that mean? As usual, you take an harmonic variation in the transverse direction, and you look for the frame surface here, and you look for a Laplace transform in time, if you like. You look to this to say that in simple words, you look to such a simple form of the solution where K is given and sigma is unknown. K is the wave number, and you look for the growth rate, as usual. Now, you have to be careful to the fact that when you are dealing with now a field which depends on space, on the two space variables, x and y, now in front of this term here, which is Fourier term, you have a function of x. So you are going by this trick to change, as I said before, partial differential equation in ordinary differential equation. So I may skip some detail if I want to. Yes, I have, how much I have? I have 10 minutes more, okay. So, you know, now you look for an expression in space for the pressure, which is exponential x. You look for such a solution with L here, which is an unknown, and you have two plus and minus because you have two waves. You have two solutions of this problem. So maybe I skip this. Okay. Here, you know, you may solve, when you know how the pressure is varying at the Neumann state, you may solve the full acoustic wave because it took out the pressure. So to solve an acoustic wave, you only need to know what the pressure is in function of time at the surface. And you can express this in terms of the variation of the evolution of the surface. Now you have this, this is the acoustic wave. And now, because this is going, you know, this acoustic wave, which can be computed by the pressure, give you some flow velocity at the Neumann state. In order to know what is going to be the flow velocity for the vorticity wave, you have to take the difference between the flow velocity, which is given by the Rankine-Ugonio condition, minus the flow velocity obtained at x equals zero coming from the acoustic. When you do that, you obtain this form here. So you solve everything. And now, the only thing that you have to do is to apply the incompressibility. And you end up with this when you use, now you have to use the expression at the Neumann state that I've given for the pressure, for the velocity. You put that in terms of the variation of the flame dynamics, of the front dynamics, excuse me, it is not a flame, of the shock dynamics, so alpha, and I go fast. Okay, I show that you, this equation is simplified. Oh, by the way, for those who are interested in the future to solve this problem, don't look to Landau and Lifshitz. This is the only chapter with Landau and Lifshitz book, and in fact, Landau was died when this part was written. It was written by Lifshitz. He did not mention, he did not see that there is a simplification in this relation in red that I show that in red. And so you obtain, he gave you a third order differential, an algebraic equation of third order to solve, that it's much more difficult to solve. In fact, there is a root which is trivial. I took out this root, and this was done also by Buckmaster and Lutford. So in that case, you know, this S here is in fact what we are looking at. We are looking at to the growth rate, which is reduced here by the velocity of the sound times the wave number, and the scaling here, which is a factor which is convenient to introduce to simplify the presentation. So the unknown is sigma, or this capital S. Now, this is the equation you obtain when you put in the equation the value that are coming from the Rankine-Ugonio condition. So here are the linear Rankine-Ugonio condition. Put that in this equation. You have to use the downstream boundary condition that you are looking for bounded condition at infinity, and because you don't want divergence at infinity, so this is going to simplify a little to select the correct solution. I skip the detail. I want to go linear rate. I want to go, here is the equation. Okay, forget about what is written in this. This is for the specialist who likes to do the calculation by themselves. Because you will not find this calculation in details in the literature. So this is why I take time to write, because even in the original paper, it's too complicated. It's mixed in many things. So here you may follow exactly what I want to say. Here is the equation. This is a general equation for a shock you say, oh my goodness, it is an equation. S is the linear, reduced linear growth rate. And you have, in this problem, you have two parameters. One is, I will be back to this parameter, but one is, here is R, is this R here. This is the slope of the Hugoniot condition, of the Hugoniot curve at the point at the Neumann state, and the other is a measure of the Mach number. So you have two scalar Mach number what is this letter here? N. Okay, N and M are the same. So you see you have two scalar N, Mn, and this scalar here, R, which is here, so one characterizes the speed of the speed of the shocks that you are interested in, and the other is, and this is general. It's not only for gas, it's general what I have written here. And now this equation takes the form of a quadratic equation, a big quadratic equation for the square. Ah, but this, when you have a big quadratic equation, that you may analyze this. And this is not written in the book of the the way that Landau writes that is much more elaborated because he did not simplify by one of the trivial solution. So let me give you the result. Okay, here are the two parameters. When R sigma is negative, you are stable. When it is positive, let me give you the result. Okay, I will be back to that. Okay. Now you have here. I am plotting R, and I have different. This R has different critical value for different value of the Mach number. So for critical values that depend on the Mach number. Okay, on for R that are in that direction, you are strongly unstable because the growth rate is positive. For R larger than this critical value here, you are strongly stable in the sense that the real part is negative, so that you damped the perturbation exponentially. And in between, you have neutral waves that are waves, these are oscillatory modes that are neither amplified nor damped exponentially. So and as you see, there is a wide range of the parameter where the mode have real part which is negative. In that case, what is the result of linear analysis? It turns out that there are two ways to look at the stability of such solution when you have neutral mode. In fact, this, because of the form of the dispersion relation, the initial form, you have a square root somewhere. Okay, here you have the square root. And I kill this square root by taking the square of everything. But because of this square root, the time dependence of the evolution of the amplitude of the is not exponential. It's going to be a power law in the temperature and power law with the time. And the power law, you cannot get that by an exponential. This means that the exponential tells you neutral because there is no exponential or growth rate or exponential damping because the growth rate will be t power something or 1 over t power something. This cannot be described by an exponential. So you have to use, in fact, to solve this problem, Laplace transform. And if you do that, you will find that and I'll give you the result. The result is that this part here, you are damped in this domain. You are damped as a power law, 1 over t power to the 1/3 for the gas. And in the other, you are exponentially grows. No, not exponential. You are growing at a rate which is not exponential. This is makes the problem difficult. Let me tell you that now there is another way to talk about the stability. This was understood by the Russian long time ago, that it depends on the orientation of the acoustic wave. If the acoustic wave are radiating downward, propagating downward, in that case, you are unstable. If the wave are propagating upward, which is called non-radiating, you should be considered to be stable in the sense that there is no exponential. So this is, okay, it's time to a break, to a 15. I start at 14. No? So I have one more. Is that right? No, I have no more. At what time do I start? Okay. So it is a break now. Okay, 40 minute break.